Good afternoon and welcome to the August 3rd, 2016 Board of Education meeting for Queen Anne's County. May I have a motion to go into closed session?
So moved.
Second.
You have to read.
She has to read.
As permitted by the Section 3-305C of the General Provision Article of the Annotated Code of Maryland, I move that we go into closed session to discuss an administrative item from Dr.
C. Ayatollah
regarding school health services. Also, to receive legal advice from Counsel Eisenberg regarding the Title IX and to discuss collective bargaining and to review the HR report and meetings minutes from July the 6th.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Do I have any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to go into closed session. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. We will return at 6 o'clock.
Awesome.
Welcome to the Board of Education meeting. This is a public meeting that is being videotaped for the county citizens to review on QACTV7, a local cable station. The agenda is available on the information table. And during this meeting, we ask that you would turn off your cell phones and or pagers, hold personal conversations and comments outside of the meeting room. We will now be led by our presentation by our president, Jennifer George.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening and welcome to the August 3rd, 2016 Board of Education meeting. At this time, I would like to ask for a motion to approve the minutes of open and closed session of July 6th.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to approve the minutes of open and closed session of July 6th. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. Also, next I ask for approval of the agenda as presented.
To make a motion to amend the agenda as presented to include to talk about extending our teacher contracts for another 30 days.
Second.
I have a motion and I have a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion?
And I move to amend the agenda by eliminating section 2.03.
Okay. I have two motions.
Second that.
Okay, thank you. So I need any questions or comments regarding the two motions? Hearing none,
Jennifer,
I call.
Jennifer, we do the first, her motion first, and then my motion. You have to do them separately.
Okay, but you made your motion first.
We do hers first.
Okay. I'm sorry.
It's okay.
Any questions or comments regarding the motion to adjourn the agenda to eliminate section 2.03 Open Meetings Act?
So moved.
Okay, hearing none, I call for the vote to amend the agenda to eliminate 2.03 Open Meetings Act. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. Second motion is to any questions or comments regarding the motion to, I believe it is, to add the discussion of extension of the teacher's contract for an additional 30 days. Any questions or comments? Hearing none, I call for the vote to amend the agenda to add a discussion of the extension of the teacher's contract for an additional 30 days. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. And next on the agenda, the recognitions.
Approval of the agenda with those
it's already approved. Once it's amended, it's approved.
Yeah, that's what we had that last time.
Yes.
That's what Rochelle had told us last time.
It's done.
Never mind.
Now the Open Meetings Act. The Open Meetings Act.
No,
oh, that's right.
We did that. That was
got it. Thank
we're
you.
We're on to recognitions.
Thank you.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Tonight we have the Energizer Bunny.
Come on down. Come on with us.
Good evening. Tonight, we would like to express our appreciation and thanks for the efforts of our talented staff. The QACPS Energizer Bunny Award is given to an employee or volunteer who just keeps going. Their energy is endless and their hard work always shines through. This award is sponsored by Mr. Chip Brittingham, Mr. Wayne Humphreys, as well as Mr. Mark Humphreys at Bayview Financial. This month, Mr. Kintop, principal of Stevensville Middle School, has nominated quite a few Energizer Bunnies from his school. Would Jacqueline Tomey, Aaron Kelly, Dan Corso, Lynn Evans, Julie Pearson, Vera Wolski, Janine Necessary, Jennifer Schreckengast, Jen Reed, wow, it's like an all-star lineup, Mr. Kintop, and Jen Weiss, please come forward. Now the good stuff. During the last 2 weeks of school, the media specialist, the individual who's in charge of Chromebook collection, was out due to medical reasons. This left a huge task to be filled of collecting, organizing, logging over 500 Chromebooks. Mrs. Tomey helped take charge. Through teamwork and efforts from everyone, this time-consuming and complex task was accomplished. For those of you that don't know how this process is completed, it goes as follows. Teachers were given sheets for every child in their room where they marked any issues with the Chromebooks. The teachers tagged and bagged and then stacked them in their rooms. These ladies brought all 500 Chromebooks to their media center, organized them, and based on a preliminary work order, then by significance of issue, wow, this is complex, and also identified fully functioning Chromebooks and organized them alphabetically by grade for next year's distribution. These ladies also took on the task of tracking down missing Chromebooks by making sure parents were notified and returned the device. Mr. Kintop says, and I quote, "I am truly grateful to work with each of these ladies. They did not complain or take this responsibility lightly. The first words when they were finished were, 'What can I do now?' Wow. The motivation and dedication shown by these educators and professionals is a true example of an Energizer Bunny. Their endless efforts are what helped Stevensville Middle School have such a successful end of the year. Thank you so much for all that you do on behalf of the Queen Anne's County Public Schools and your community in the Stevensville Middle School area." Congratulations. Kintop, the nominator.
Can I scoot over?
Yep.
I'll stand behind.
I will too.
Jack, you're the bunny holder. Jack, you're the bunny holder.
Here, wait a minute. I'm going to move Arlene.
1, 2, 3.
Congratulations. You can just do it. You got a whole year.
She's got it right there.
Is it on top though? She needs to read the statement.
Is it on the statement for public comment?
Okay, next on the agenda, we have the citizen participation and public comment section. Ms. Arlene?
Oh, for public comment?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yep, I read it. I'm gonna make up something.
Isn't that your binder?
Gotta be big binder, honey. Is it on top of it?
You can read it if you want.
Sorry, ladies and gentlemen.
Okay. All speakers should sign the roster, including their telephone number and address. Comments should be limited to 2 minutes in length. Comments no longer than 2 minutes should be submitted in writing. The questions or statements to the board should relate to a recent agenda item, an agenda item that is expected to appear in the future, or a matter of general policy over which the board has authority. Please do not discuss items related to negotiations. Those items are to be discussed at the bargaining table. First, we'll have Kevin Kenta. I don't know who this is.
Is that me?
Good evening, everybody. I'm here to share just some things that we found this summer at Stevensville Middle when we had our school improvement team meeting that I'd like to put for your consideration going forward. Every summer we have to take all the data that we get on student achievement, and our job is to sift through it, find where we've done well, where we need some work, and then design strategies that we can work in the future that might help make students more successful. As we do this, we have to plan our calendar for the year. And so my points are to our calendar, and I've spoken to you before about this, and I just want to reiterate. When we had our discussion at SIT Team this summer, we could not plan all the professional development that we wanted to, because we unfortunately are having to make some adjustments to increase time during the workday for teachers to have parent conferences. There are no middle school parent conferences on the calendar this year, so we have had to designate certain after-school meeting times to try to get parents in so that they can have the communications with us about the progress that their children are making. Also, when we went through the calendar for the year, when you take away time to work on grades, time to work on SLOs, and county-level professional developments, we only have 2 half-days in order for teachers to collaborate after school, and then we have 3 professional days the first week of school, which is great, but time is needed there to set up rooms and get ready for students, 1 professional day at the end of the year, which we need to pretty much close out for the year. So it only leaves us with 2 days throughout that school year to include our professional development. I heard you mention that you're still working on contracts, and I think that's going to be something that gets involved with this issue, because now that we don't have the parent conferences built into the schedule, we may need to look at creative ways with teachers and their contracts to build in some more time so that we can do that. So I just wanted to bring that to you after we had our SIT meeting. I had a large number of teachers that were on this team, and they're not angry or disappointed, but they were a little surprised now that we're having to back off of some of our professional things we do for their learning in order to have those parent conferences. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And next we'll have LC Lawrence. No, decline.
Okay.
That's it.
Anybody else would wish to speak? Okay. The next on the agenda is the student member of the board. Welcome, Anand and Paige. Welcome back. Paige, would you like to go first since your experience?
Oh, no, yeah, I have no report for finance.
Well, right.
School and storage.
Yeah. Hi, my name's Nam. I'm excited to be here, first meeting. And the only thing I have to report this month is I went to the Maryland Leadership Workshop, thanks to the Board of Education, and I want to give a little insight into what I did there. So at the Maryland Leadership Workshop, we discussed different kinds of skills, and we basically practice them. Some of those skills include advocacy, public speaking, facilitation, self-awareness, decision-making, and diversity. And the diversity workshop was one of my favorites because diversity is not something that we see a lot here, but having kids from all over Maryland, even like from the depths of like Baltimore and like Southern Maryland, it was so amazing to see everyone's experiences and lifestyles combine into one, and we got to meet and create a lot of new relationships. So my overall experience, I think that we should continue sponsoring people from Kent Island and Queen Anne's to go to the workshops because it allows those who attend to learn the experience through the workshops, but also those that you learn just by being there. Like some of those would include patience because we had to wait a lot for a lot of things, and understanding of others and relationship building because you get to meet people who are very different from you. And I really hope that you guys consider sponsoring many more people to go because it allows them to meet people from diverse backgrounds. Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Next on the agenda is the presentations. We have the transportation end of year report.
Good evening. A lot's been going on in transportation this past year, and I appreciate the opportunity to come and speak to you and share with you what we've been doing. Of course, the mission of the Transportation Department is to provide safe, timely, efficient transportation that contributes to the positive learning environment. And it takes a lot of work with staff, drivers committed to this excellence and continuous improvement. We look at the overview of the state legislative audit, comparisons within the state, and year-to-year trends as we're looking towards benchmarks that we need to make. We'll be looking today at these benchmarks, and I'm not going to read everything to you, but we'll see it as we go through to make sure that we're hitting these items and reviewing them just each year to see where we need to make improvements from year to year. We look at the audits that we've had, the legislative and MSDE audits, and these are some of the items that we are checked on in order for us to be completing the work that we need to in order to have a safe and efficient transportation system. The audits, both legislative and MSD, look at each of these things, and we some of the things that they've highlighted that we need to keep doing are utilizing our route software and verifying our contractor payments. The audits of time and mileage at all schools in September and October, we do summary audits, and then at all the school locations, and then we do ride-along audits. The ride-along audits are basically verifying that the route that they are traveling is actually what they are putting down on their mileage. The miles traveled each year at the end of the school year, we compile and send in to MSDE the amount of miles that have been traveled. You can see that we have an increase over this year compared to last, and you can see the program over the years. It's important to look at this each year to see where you are. One thing I added this year was the number of school days, because that would affect the number of miles that you ended up traveling, and also will reflect the number of hours. Also, program changes within a year, and particularly this year with special needs, we had a number of students that were going over to Kennedy Krieger that ended up having an attendant. In the past, we didn't have an attendant. Another example was special needs students traveling from one part of the county to another part, more so for programs that they needed. Still another, this past year, we made some improvements with anchor points, the students picking more of them up at their home instead of locations where they would have to travel to, just for some examples. You can see the driver and attendance hours also, you know, how they're reflected here, and some of those changes that I shared with you are reflective in this. Yes.
Let me ask along, going along here. One question on it is the special eds, you said they had to be transported to different programs. They're programs from our school system, right? I mean, we don't take them to their doctors or anything like that, right? It's just schools programs.
Mm-hmm. Yes, programs, and I work closely with Dr. McGowan in order to look at student placement too, you know, where the programs are, but things do come up during the middle part of a year, or, you know, once programs have been established, and looking at other years, you know, where certain services might be delivered at different schools. Again, you can see the driver and attendant hours. Another thing that we also added this year, towards the end of the school year, were people who just had were just attendants and not driver and attendants. So we'll be seeing some changes with that in reflection on the amount of hours, too. The fact sheet, really nothing has changed as far as county bus special needs buses, what we did do this past year, and this also helped increase the mileage a little bit. At Kent Island High School, we found an overload last year at the beginning of the school year. We had to put a county bus in the morning to take care of that problem, and then later in the school year, we found a problem with the PM run, and we ended up putting a contractor in that. So that was, even though it wasn't adding a new bus, it was adding an additional run to an existing bus. So that changed spare activity buses down to one, while we had one of Airbus's doing a run to help with that. Going forward this school year, we've planned that those runs, change some runs around in order for the high school runs them to be absorbed by existing runs. Eligible students decreased by 24. The cost effectiveness, this is in the transportation funding per pupil, the MSD fact book, where you can see this year per pupil it's $899. Last year was $891. Compared to some of the other counties there. The next was in the fact book, the number of drivers. Let me see if I skipped one. Safety, this, I didn't want to skip by this. We only had 7 accidents this year. From that, there was one that was non-preventable, 6 preventable, 3 happened to hit the threshold of over $1,500. Reportable to MSDE. We keep records of these in order to look at training that we need to do in upcoming years. So we're real pleased with that. Last year we had 19, the year before 18. This is just the number of drivers that we, certified drivers that we have is 144. bus driver evaluations over the year. We did 91 this school year for 63% of the total. This gives you an idea of the experience air drivers have along with their age, because it's something that we're always concerned about is retention of drivers, and also you know, looking at where air pool of drivers will be, you know, in the future. This year we were fortunate. Outstanding bus driver of the year, James Fisher, was honored. He has a 22 years of service, and certainly not only him, but lots of drivers have many years of experience with us. Mr. Fisher is certainly an outstanding bus driver, and I just wanted to mention him again. Also, Jeannie Nickens from the Operations Center was the outstanding employee, and she has a tremendous job on the radios, dispatching, and keeping track of field trips, you know, throughout the school day. County drivers, we have 20 regular drivers for special needs runs. There's 67 regular disabled runs during the school day to and from school, and then lots of other runs that we have: shuttle bus runs, far school runs, runs to transition programs, after school and summer runs, and also field trip. The other schools that we service on a daily basis and even during the summer are some of these schools: Benedictine, Harbor, Maryland School for the Blind, High Roads, Kennedy Krieger, and this year more homeless students than we've ever had before, transported from Kent County and Talbot County, which added tremendously also, you know, to air numbers. And this is a statewide trend of more homeless students to be transported.
Why do the homeless children from those two counties come to Queen Anne's County? Those counties don't have that facility to?
It ends up that, well, there's different locations, you know, where different children are located, or if air students or happen to go over for whatever their individual circumstances were to another county. Now we work with those counties too in order to get the transportation worked out. But it is a statewide issue, and we have to work closely together in order between counties too, is transporting these students.
Are they in home? I'm sorry.
I'm still unclear. Kent County doesn't take homeless students, so we
anybody can have homeless students.
Right.
It's where air students were and where they're going to, or where they're living and they want to come back to air schools, or vice versa. In Talbot County, it was some of air's child, one of air students was there, wanting to come back to their home school.
So it's children that are in homeless shelters is what it is in Talbot and Caroline or Kent County?
Well, they're a designated homeless student. There's okay. Different criteria, you know, for each of those students. And of course, this is the McKinney-Vento Act that we have to adhere to. Most recently, within this school year, we did have this past June training CPR, first aid training for our county drivers. And training is so important in order, especially for all students, but for the special needs students, we need to have our drivers kept up to date with what they need to for those particular students and all students. Bus evacuation drills, just a reminder that we had started them back in 2014-15 as far as the high school sports teams. We continue. We're focusing more on the evacuation drills. Tomorrow we have an in-service coming up for the upcoming school year for all of our drivers. And one of the sessions is working directly with that, and then a designated one just for the special needs. Opt out for bus transportation. These are the totals that we had for 2014 and then 2015. They're still in the 700 range. It certainly has been helpful at this point for us knowing who is on or not on a bus for us to route the buses most efficiently. We've still used Roscoe Grid, and I just wanted to bring that because it's something that we put an investment in, having the lines painted at Queen Anne's County, Ken Allen, and Settlersville Middle School for these to be checked with the buses. We have a transportation advisory committee that meets twice a year with parents, administrators, police, bus contractors, transportation and police agencies. We have a lot of items on there, on our agenda, but we're certainly, it started out looking at severe budget deficits. We're looking at safety in particular these days, along with the other items. One of the big things that we brought up at the May meeting was looking at the delays that we have, 90-minute, two-hour combinations, and it was basically at that meeting was recommended to go with the 90 minutes again this year. On the transportation website, under delays, all of the delays since 2012 are listed, if anyone is ever interested. So these are just some examples of things that have been discussed. We also have regular scheduled...
Sorry, could you go back to that?
Sure.
I'm sorry, Ms. Kavanaugh. So the red light runners,
yes,
have been talked about?
Yes. And I have some more information about them,
okay,
coming up.
Okay, thank you. I'm sorry. I just
okay, that's fine. Oops, wrong way. These are the bus company meetings that I schedule regularly, just some items that have been brought up at these meetings on a regular basis. We have bus route reviews. During these reviews, these are some dates that we met to go over, looking at the routes that we currently have and making adjustments. Staff meetings that we have, and the initiatives that we've had for this past year, quite a few of them, and we'll be going through these. The alternate bus transportation request form last year that we put in certainly allows us to know more information if a child happens to have more than the AM and PM assignment that they have, if they need another one. This is, with an exception, has helped us to locate it on our transportation software to keep track of where people are. This bus stop survey has given information, so people, when people are concerned about their bus stop, we have a survey form that they can fill out, so we have all the information. Here's the violations of the eight-way flashing lights. This past year, it went up. We had 73 violations compared to 67 from the previous year. We did participate in the nationwide school bus illegal passing survey. It just happened this year. We only had one violation. We had a number that participated, handed it in. But the real key up here is it is increasing. We work closely with the sheriff's office, state police, media coverage that we had information in the newspaper, you know, on our website too. So that's something that we are continuing to address. Other thing this year, the website revision and transportation, you may want to take a look at this sometime. This inclement weather information, that tab will give you information of all the days that we've had off for many, many years and for what reason. InfoFinder LE, this past year, what this is a access to our transportation routing system, which is called TransFinder. This allows the schools to go in and have up-to-the-minute access to the transportation department reports, so they can run them off and not have to call and ask us, but have up-to-date information to give parents too. The training was held at the schools, and the school secretaries were trained along with the administrators. This year, two athletic trips were scheduled through InfoFinder LE, starting with the fall or winter, well, the winter sports. Angel Tracks cameras are on all buses. Mr. Pinder and I did an interview with WPBOC this past September, and certainly we keep them up, have a contract. We, with our bus inspections, the Angel Tracks people were there getting them ready for this upcoming school year, making sure everything was working properly. The initiatives for this coming school year, transportation newsletter was started, but to continue with that, looking at more transportation job fairs. We did have one in the spring, looking at one for the fall and spring of this coming, this school year. Continuation evaluation of routes, and continue to work closely with police on vehicles passing the red flashing lights and see if there's anything else that we can do with that. And working closely with special ed and student support services in order to look at savings and how to be as efficient as we can, you know, with transporting special needs students along with homeless students. Another thing, information on bus schedules, exploring ways that we can inform parents better about bus routes. That's one of the initiatives for this year. And flagger training for school personnel will be taking place at the end of August. Short, a lot, and there's more information in here when you have time to, you know, go back and take a look at. But we've been busy and certainly do appreciate all the support the schools have given and the contractors and drivers. You know, without them, they're out there every day looking at what's going on with the children, and we certainly appreciate it. Any questions?
Anybody have any questions? No. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next on the agenda, we have an update on Maryland's use of assessment and testing in public schools.
And while Mr. Watkins, our supervisor of mathematics, and Mr. Brown, our supervisor of accountability, are coming to the table, before they start, I just want to give you a little bit of background. If you remember, almost a year to the date when the 2015 Maryland General Assembly started the Assessment Commission to look at assessment all across the state of Maryland. And if you remember, Mr. Brown and I presented to you just about a year ago on that, and we had to take, as a board, had to take a position based upon that. We advanced 1 year. And by the law, one of the things that we have to do is really report back to you on the findings that the Assessment Commission has found over this past year as they worked with all the jurisdictions across the state of Maryland. So what these gentlemen are going to present to you this evening is a very, very brief executive summary of the findings. And what we have to do as a Board of Education is to either accept or reject those findings. So they're going to give you a big picture overview, and then the Division of Curriculum Instruction, as well as our administrators, are going to look at all those recommendations and then come back to you with a we either reject or we accept that finding. And the last thing is that we have to, as a Board of Education, have to send a letter to the Maryland State Department of Education by September the 1st with whether or not we accept or reject the findings. Gentlemen?
Very good.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
As I was reviewing the slides, I realized I left off one critical piece of information. So I'm going to begin with that. Great things continue to happen in Queen Anne's County Public Schools. Now, to our state report, as Mr. Puglisi said, tonight we're going to be looking at the overview of the commissioner's reports, at least their recommendations, and we're going to identify actions and let you know what the next steps for Queen Anne's County Public Schools are. And Mr. Puglisi pretty much went through that already with you.
Agreed.
Again, last year, Maryland General Assembly established a commission to review the assessments in Maryland. Both the local, national, and federally mandated assessments were under fire. And through this report, the commission is now making its recommendations available to the General Assembly, the state and local school boards, and the governor of Maryland.
Last summer, as Mr. Paluski illustrated, that we filled out a survey to kind of explain to the state of Maryland how much assessment we're given in each of our grade levels. Each of the 24 districts participated in that, and the findings were reported back to us in the fall of last year. As a result of the commission's findings, they put together a timeline that required each district to respond, and that September 1st is the deadline. As a result of, after the MSD collects all of the findings of the local districts, then they will take those recommendations, compile them, and create their own recommendation to the governor's office by October 1st.
So again, tonight we're going to look at primarily the recommendations from the State Board, from the Commission to the State Board of Education and the local school boards. The first charge that the Commission had was to survey and assess how much time is spent at each grade level in each local school system on administering state, local, and federal mandate assessments. Again, each school system was surveyed last year, and the recommendations that they made will actually fall under two other charges that we'll be talking about later that deal with the amount of assessment. The second charge is to review the purpose of all the assessments administered by local school systems, both summative and formative assessments, and whether there are some that are duplicative or otherwise unnecessary. And the commission came back with four recommendations, two of them directed towards MSDE and two directed towards local school systems. Towards MSDE, they've come back with a recommendation that the state does not pursue the proposed middle school social studies test that's been waiting to be instituted for the past couple of years. And they're also proposing a restructuring of the HSA government test to make it fit more nicely into single period assessments or single period sections. Sorry, currently, that's a 2.5 hour test.
Is the middle school what?
The middle school assessment will not go through the middle school social studies. But the government HSA, which we are currently giving, they would like to restructure that so that it would fit nicely into regular class period times rather than a 2.5 hour chunk of testing that causes the schools to adjust their schedule. To the local school systems, they're recommending that no assessment's primary purpose should be just for establishing an SLO for the teacher evaluation. And they are also recommending that no more than two teacher-developed SLOs should be used for the purpose of a teacher evaluation.
Charge three talked about reviewing and analyzing the local school systems and the MSD's interests in requiring assessments and attempt to develop a statewide approach to administering assessments. And the recommendation that came out of Charge 3 was for the MSD to loosen the restrictions on who can administer, proctor, and provide accommodations on state and locally mandated assessments. This new regulation would allow any staff member deemed capable by the principal to fully proctor a state or local assessment. Essentially, this charge deals with the idea that instruction time is lost due to the fact that schedules in high schools, elementary schools, and middle schools are dictating, testing schedules are dictating instruction. So what they're suggesting is loosen up the regulations for folks other than certified teachers to give these assessments might create more opportunities for certified teachers to stay in the classroom while testing is happening in the building. Charge four, determine whether the local and state's current local and state schedules for administering assessments allots enough time between administering a formative assessment and receiving the results of the formative assessment to meaningfully inform instruction. One of their findings was there was a good amount of lead time between when a child takes an assessment, such as PARC, and when the results are given to the local agencies. So their recommendations to MSD was to establish a July 15th deadline for the return of all PARC assessment data, to establish a stakeholders group which will provide feedback on testing windows and all testing elements, time elements for the assessment. So essentially, charge forward, their recommendations is to go back and just re-examine how quickly the local districts are getting their time, getting their data back.
Before we go on,
sure.
We're going to have to make some decisions on this when you're done.
That's correct.
So what is your recommendations on these recommendations? You're not telling us that.
The decision does not have to be made tonight.
Because you have to turn this in September 1st.
What we will be doing is developing an executive summary with recommendations based on a survey we'll be conducting with some key stakeholders, primarily being the curriculum instruction staff. And that will include a list of recommendations that we think should be accepted or rejected and reasoning behind that, that we will actually put in your hands in writing.
You may have said that. I just didn't understand. Thank you.
Charge 5 deals with looking at the assessment windows and determining if the assessment windows are having negative effects on instruction, on materials, and on equipment use, and school calendars. And to the local school systems, the commission recommends that local superintendents annually report on the number of hours spent on mandated local and state assessments and the number of days in which the school schedule has been changed school-wide for mandated assessments. They are also recommending that local school systems and MSDE, or two MSDE in local school systems, that all local, state, and federally mandated assessments results be provided in a timely fashion so that they may be used to inform instruction and aid in planning of programming decisions, which is very similar to what we talked about by the July 15th date for PARC. Recommendations directly to MSDE, that they would like MSDE to update the Maryland Maryland Accessibility Features and Accommodation Manual with accommodation guidelines that would be effective in the implementation of all state assessments. Conduct a technology needs assessment to determine the implication for administering the mandated federal, state, and local assessments. And also to provide an annual need-based competitive technology grant to minimize the impact on instruction for those schools with limited technology that are forced to extend the testing window simply due to the lack of computers. Charge 6 is to consider the implications for the state if changes were made to the Elementary and Secondary Education Act that would allow for more flexibility in the administering of assessments. And these recommendations all go to MSDE. The commission would like MSDE to reinforce the idea that the proposed state-mandated middle school social studies test not be enacted as originally proposed. Since the biology curriculum is currently undergoing changes, the biology graduation requirement should be suspended for the 2016-17 school year, with exemptions granted to students who may have failed the biology HSA assessment prior to the 16-17 school year. And there shall be no biology bridge program for the 2017-18 school year. They also recommend that the Maryland Integrated Science Assessment, or the MISA test, be designed in a format that will be least disruptive to the school schedule, so that each section of the test would be able to be completed within a designated class period of time. Again, so that instruction is not displaced, students are not held in one testing room rather than being able to proceed to their next classes.
Charge 7 has several parts to it and 7 recommendations associated with it. It talks about how local school systems in the state can improve the process in which mandated assessments are administered and used to inform instruction. If the commission finds that the allotted time for administering assessments is resulting in reduced instruction time, the most efficient and effective methods to ensure that adequate time is allotted to both administering assessments and instruction. It talks about which developmentally appropriate elements, if any, should be included in the assessment administered to kindergarten students, and it allows the commission to talk about any other relevant issue identified. So the first commission is directed at local districts and identifies the need to publicize information comparing the 2015 and 2016 PARC results, and then it further asks each district to establish a district committee on assessment for the purpose of monitoring, evaluating, and communicating the district's assessment program. The committee would reflect the diversity and size of our schools and be assembled no later than December 2017. This Charge 7 identifies other recommendations made to MSD, such as reporting out PARC results by mode effect, that is, the performance on kids when they take the test in paper pencil or when they take it online, really identifying how kids perform on each of those methods. It expresses the need for MSD to develop a clear process to collect, report, and respond to concerns regarding the PARC assessment and develop a statewide practitioner stakeholder group to work with PARC. It asks MSD to work closely with local districts to improve communication, administration, and professional development for the kindergarten readiness assessment. It asks MSD to seek other assessment options that satisfy federal high school assessment requirements and improve college and career readiness. And talks about MSD providing resources and information to parents on state mandated assessments. Lastly, Charge 7 requires local boards of education to communicate with parents before, during, and after testing by publishing a testing calendar, providing information that helps parents to understand why students are tested and the content material that is on the tests, explain what the results will mean, how they will be used, and how parents can access the results. Charge 8, the final charge, to ensure that any recommendation retains the ability to compare student achievement across local school systems, the state, and the nation. The recommendation for this one is very simple. It is to administer the PARC assessments to satisfy the high school assessment requirements and the participation requirement of 95% as specified by the Every Student Succeeds Act and the state board requirements. These regulations are already on the books, so it basically says follow the high school assessment guidelines already established. So let me talk about the next steps as we go forward from this. So as Dave said, that we're going to collect information from the Department of Instruction and collect input. Then we will prepare an executive summary for preparation and writing to the Board of Education to collect your input. And then we will work with you to develop a letter to meet the September 1st deadline to MSDE. The entire report can be found, actually all the notes can be found at the commission website, noted there, and if you would like to see the entire report, all 85 pages or so of it, it can be found at that link.
Does anybody have any questions right now?
So you're going to put your recommendations together and send it all to all of us so that we can vote on it? Is that what I'm understanding?
Yes, yes. What we had discussed is, to make this simple for you, is that what we'll probably do is say, we agree with all the findings except the following, and then outline that to you to make it simple, and then we can cross-reference it to the audit report, and that way it'll make it very, very simple so that you can see which particular findings maybe that we rejected and then a clear rationale as to why.
Right. Could we get the findings and recommendations for each charge? Can we get that emailed to us? Because listening to it, but when I
you
read
mean
it.
All, the entire report?
Of each charge, like on our presentation, it you know gives us a charge and then it just had findings and recommendations with Mr. Watkins and Mr. Brown had discussed, but I'd like to like be able to sit down and read them.
Sure, we can provide you with a. You want the whole, or you just want
just for the charge? Just what they okay. Just.
I'm going.
Just
they're on the link, right? They're on the link.
Are you on the link, or are you on the? You want to attach to the power, website?
I was on the PowerPoint.
I mean, for the PowerPoint.
So it's on the link, then?
Oh, yeah, the whole report is on
the link. Okay, then I can just go there.
We just wanted to condense it.
Okay.
Report, or we could send you the appendix, which is just a summary of the findings and...
Okay, no, that's...
So we're trying to make it a simple for you.
And then the second one is that correct? The first one, is the summary, and the second one is the whole 85 pages?
The first one shows all the minutes, shows everything related to the commission's meetings. The second link, the official final report, is the one you're going to want to click on.
Okay.
That's what this is.
Okay, great, thank you.
Sure.
This is George.
So your recommendations are prior to their recommendations?
No, we just reviewed the findings and the recommendations of the commission. Now we will provide you a written executive summary in the coming weeks of the recommendations that we think the Queen Anne's County Public Schools should take. We're in the process of collecting feedback from other folks on the team.
Tammy?
Anand has a question.
Anand?
I did have a question, but now I completely understand what's going on now. Okay, so initially I believe that you were giving us your recommendations, but you have not filed that yet. So I had a question about, just to answer my own curiosity, if you had any data statistics about how many students actually do fail the biology HSA, and if they do fail, how many pass the next year, and if it is necessary for them to be excused.
For the class of 2017, 97% of our students have participated in the test. I can't tell you off the top of my head what number has actually passed the test, but we were just asked to calculate the number that have participated, because we do need to meet that 95% participation for the federal government. We've already met that.
So you have like no idea right now about how many do actually pass the biology HSA?
I could send you that data.
That would be, I'm just curious, because if it is, taken away, it's curious to know if it's actually worth to be taken away. That's all. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you. Anybody else have any questions or comments? Yeah. No? Thank you.
Have a good evening.
Thank you.
Too. Thank you. Mr. Watkins, Mr. Brown.
Next on the agenda is the QACPS Innovation Center.
So I'm just going to PowerPoint this way.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
If it's okay, I'd like to stand because I'm very passionate about our school district. Mm-hmm. Tonight, I'd like to present to you about the first QACPS Innovation Center.
Wait a minute. Let's try this again.
So the whole purpose of this presentation is for one reason and one reason only, and that is to discuss a system-level approach in order to address the recent curriculum management audit findings in a very systemic way that is really driven by one purpose and one purpose only, and that's to close the achievement gap for all students. So I ask this question: what do we do as an organization? In very simple terms, we make learning so exciting for our youngest learners that they become global graduates that have successful careers. In one simple way, that's exactly what we do as an organization. And there's another way to look at it, and that is when you look at the core function of schools and school systems, it really comes down to productivity and output divided by input. And as a school system, our productivity is about teaching and learning. And our output is that all students are able to graduate on time, college, career, and civic ready. And we divide that by our input. And that means all students and all resources to educate all students. All resources, whether those are human resources, whether that is time as a resource, whether that is a material resource, are all things moving in the same direction that get us intended results
over a long period of time. So let me set the context by saying this, that since 2010, you probably remember the acronym Race to the Top. And beginning in Race to the Top, we started this transition into new standards, into new assessments, into new instructional approaches. And over the period of 5 to 6 years, our teachers in our classrooms have seen so many significant educational reform initiatives hit them, hit their doorstep, and hit their classroom all at the same time. Whether that was new standards, the Maryland College and Career Readiness Standards, new assessments, new approaches, universal design for learning, teacher-principal evaluation. And that was a lot of change in our classrooms and for our principals, and our teachers have done a great job at that. But we have to take that into context. The second is, as Mr. Watkins and Mr. Brown had expressed, was the Maryland Assessment Commission, really looking at how much that we're assessing students. And since 2014, our local initiative of moving towards a one-to-one, and I'm proud to say that this year we'll phase that, and our last phase is grades 3 and 4. That's very exciting. We've done some phenomenal work. And the last part of that is really to say this, is that's a lot of change that's happened in a short amount of time. And that's why this is really about thinking about our system and our system-level goals and what we're driven by as a school system. Our primary driver is academic excellence, and certainly about a safe and secure environment for all of our students. Our high-quality workforce, and Mr. Farley talks about this extensively, and how do we ensure a high-quality workforce for all of our workers, all of our teachers, and how do we ensure more diversity across our school system? Our organizational effectiveness, and that is from budget and finance to operations to human resources, all those things that support classroom teachers with doing their job and helping them to support their job to doing it the best that they can. And certainly we use the last phrase of that, which is equity. And that's really encompasses all the work that we do, looking at equity and equality across the entire school system. Most recently, at our last board meeting, Dr. Thunberg presented on our curriculum management audit that we just got the full report this week, released that on Monday. And those 5 key standards, which are very important, that's looking at the overall organizational effectiveness piece of governance and leadership, from the superintendent to the board, and setting policy and using that policy and looking at it, how it drives teaching and learning. Clear instructional valid objectives, that really gets down into the core and the heart of curriculum and the components of curriculum and how that can support a teacher to be able to reach and teach more kids. The connectivity and equity as we look at kids articulate from pre-K to 12. Assessment and feedback, similar to some of the findings and recommendations that Mr. Watkins and Mr. Brown. And then productivity. How are we using our resources? Could we be using them even more effectively and even more efficiently to get to our bottom line? So over 100 days, having been in the organization a little over the year, I personally had spent from July of when I entered the organization into January, over 100 days, and challenged myself with this. How much could I learn from people in our organizations by simply listening? I listened to teachers. I listened to community members. I listened to administrators. I listened to supervisors. I've listened to a lot of people, and the thing that I was looking for the most, I was looking for organizational pain points. What are people in the organization talking about that need attention? Not just one person, but more than one person. And that leads you to want to investigate more in that area. So the voice of the school system, of what I heard for over 100 days, are 5 driving themes. I heard the theme of organizational effectiveness. I heard the theme from our school system around early childhood and school readiness. We know the importance of that in order to achieve the gap, in order to close the achievement gap earlier. Certainly my passion, which I know is the best support that we could provide a teacher, and that's about a highly aligned, well-designed curriculum with our instructional tools and assessments. That's the best support that we can provide a teacher as well as professional development, because that directs the instructional delivery on a daily basis. If you remember Dr. Thunberg, he talked about the alignment triangle, the work plan, which is the curriculum, the work, which is how teachers deliver that, and then the work measure, how we assess that. We have great leaders in our school system, and I stand behind every one of them. But we also have to look at reaching down in a school system and reaching down to pull the next level of leader that aspires to do that work. And so I heard a lot about leadership. I heard about asking for more opportunities to be involved at another level to prepare them for the next level. I also heard a lot of conversation about building capacity, leadership capacity, and also professional development and learning. I heard that from teachers. I heard that from supervisors. But it's not only about teachers and supervisors and principals. It's about our custodians. How do we provide more professional development and opportunities for all of our employees to learn and grow? And last is monitoring progress and performance. How we continue to move the needle in achievement is to stay focused on the main thing. And how we look at monitoring progress over a period of time consistently. I asked our school system, I asked our administrators really some simple questions. Number one, what does it take to close the achievement gap by the end of grade two? Number one, in October, how well are our kids doing across the school system in reading and mathematics as an example? What resources do we need to shift in order to redirect to be able to close the achievement gap even faster? How are they doing in January? Do we need to redirect things and refocus our resources so we get kids what they need on time, in need, in an efficient and effective way? And that is really this notion of what I listened to for over 100 days, more than 6 months. This was the voice to me of our school system of saying, these are some areas that could use some attention. We've done great things. We continue to do great things. We're going to build on great things. But we also know that there's great room for improvement. These are the next very, very two key slides that I really want to draw your attention to of why I believe that the Innovation Center is going to transform our organization and catapult student achievement across our organization. And I'm talking really about organizational alignment. So you see on the left really is why. What drives us? And that's our strategic plan. Those are our key drivers that are going to take us and what we move towards as an organization. Then it becomes, how do we measure? What are the indicators in that strategic plan? How do we measure that? And then what are the actions? What are the strategies? What are the deliverables? And how do we monitor those deliverables? And that really leads us into this exciting adventure of what the Innovation Center is in the Queen Anne's County Public Schools. And I'll share that with you in a second. And that's really about action management or project management. And that's how we do the work. And that's the work of school systems, and then how we bring that information back to you as a Board of Education to help us monitor and keep in check of how we're making progress. But at the end of the day, it is really about how we organize. This is not about something new. This is about rethinking how we work as an organization. And this slide is very critical because what it shows us as an organization, what it shows us as a community, that everybody has stake in the game. Right from the Board of Education working together as a team with the superintendent, outlining the major goals and initiatives. That in turn helps with working with the executive staff and really providing the direction for the entire organization. And that is what brings us into the Innovation Center. It's really about taking those five themes and making them into five teams. And that's where really the work that we're trying to create so that we move our organization forward. Organizations have to transform. Organizations have to continue to grow, and they have to continue to progress. And they can do that very strategically when all the pieces are aligned together and they're working together. And that really gets us to implementation, something I'm very, very passionate about. And that is when we implement anything in an organization. And when we look at things, and we're guilty of this in education, that when we look and say, why didn't it work? Why didn't it work? Well, we didn't implement it with fidelity. You know, because there's many drivers, and sometimes we speed up to implement things. So really it's to collectively slow down, think about what we're doing, do it in a systemic way, and roll it out in a way that helps support teachers with getting a good fidelity of implementation. And that is really the last part in the Board of Education's piece. As we bring information to you and strategies to you and the work to you, to show you what we're working on and how it's going to make a difference overall in our organization and how it really flows back to the Board of Education to go back to meet our goals to move forward. So what is the Innovation Center? The Innovation Center, very simply, is this. It is a structure. It's a project management structure that really continues to build a culture within our organization around collaboration, innovation, and empowerment. Our teachers have the best ideas. Our principals have the best ideas. It is allowing us to listen to what their ideas are about how to solve complex challenges. And those complex challenges have to be focused on improving the instructional core. And the instructional core is around the alignment of the curriculum with the instructional tools and the assessment. Everything else in an organization should be working to support a teacher in making that happen each and every day. And I think this is exciting for us because it's allowing individuals within our organization to explore ideas to improve our organization to move forward. So very simply, the Innovation Center is taking those five themes that I talked about and really creating five organizational teams. And so each team is going to be led by a project or process manager. And they're simply the leader of that team. And that information, as they work with each one of those teams each and every month, to look at the work, and I'll explain that in a second, and they will report out monthly to the executive staff. So really, our project and process managers are going to be extensions of our executive team. So each month, our executive team's going to see the work that's going on in the organization. We'll be able to support. Is there a barrier that we can remove? Is that a budget item that we need to be looking at in order to move forward? Are we ready to implement? Do we have a professional development plan that's ready so when we roll something out, we have it well articulated, well thought out? We have the right materials in place so that teachers are not frustrated if it's being implemented, but they're actually being supported in that process. And that's just, we're just in the process of schools, that's what we do. And sometimes, as I mentioned, we've had to implement things many, many times over and over. So this process is really looking at and thinking about working differently, not more, thinking about how we're working and working differently. This is just a diagram, and you'll see that in your PowerPoint, but it's basically the teaming structure and how all of this is in the alignment to our strategic plan and back to the goals of the Board of Education on making sure that we're making progress and how do we need to be able to redirect. So this is really looking at how we use our time, how we use our resources effectively to be able to take the recommendations from the curriculum management audit, which begins the framework of our work, to move forward. So let's talk about the work. So what is the work that each team would be responsible for of those themes? Well, the first thing that's going to allow that foundation is that next week in our administrators and supervisors, one of the things that we're going to do is we're going to take apart that curriculum management audit plan. And we're going to look at the recommendations, we're going to look at the findings, and then we're going to put it up against each and every one of those teams. Where does it best fit? Is that an organizational effectiveness recommendation? Is that a curriculum instruction assessment recommendation? And so that becomes the foundation of the work. But it's also about current challenges and current initiatives within our organization. And last is in future initiatives, which I will share with you very quickly. But one, so each team's going to focus, align, prioritize the work, and then bring those deliverables forward. So I would imagine that about every other month that we'll report on our results to the Board of Education. We'll report on our results to you. We'll report on what we're doing about the recommendations and the work that we're moving forward. But most exciting is what the future could actually look like. And that is when you think about organizational effectiveness, that's about triangulating all the things that work within our school system. And really the visioning, the marketing of a school system. And why I picked 2030 is I think is very key for us as an organization. And I talked to our staff very quickly about 3 years that I think are very important. The year 2021, 2026, and 2030. 2030 is 14 years away, seems like forever. But guess what? Students that enter pre-kindergarten today will graduate in the year 2030. They will be in eighth grade in the year 2021. They'll be in grade 3. I'm sorry, I got that mixed up. 2026, they'll be in eighth grade. They'll be in grade 3 in 2021. 2021 is around the corner. We don't have any time to waste to close the achievement gap. And I think when we think about our organization, that's only 2.5 strategic plans away. And that's why when we look at all kids, this incoming pre-kindergarten class is going to be a benchmark for us. Because now we're in a new set of standards. So we're going to look even more closely at how well those students are doing as we move forward. So we think about future work of organizational effectiveness. That's the kind of work and envisioning. And a passion certainly of mine, and that is early learning and school readiness. And I love this slide, which really talks about, you know, cradle to career, and really about how students come in our organization and move through our organization to be able to catapult further in their career.
And so when we think about our initiative around getting ready, and that's all about early learning and school readiness, we know the research is there. If we invest in early learning, students have a better shot of having a less of achievement gap. You know, we talk about looking at our interventions. Our goal is to ensure that that gap doesn't increase as students move forward. Our third team, curriculum, instructional tools, and assessment, certainly a passion of mine is, all these are passions of mine, but I will tell you that this one-stop initiative is really would make life a lot easier for teachers. We have a one-to-one initiative. One of the things we don't have is a learning management system. And you see on the left what a really learning management system is we have a lot of different programs. If a teacher goes in and looks at performance matters, they got to go log in. If they got to go look at curriculum off, they got to come out of that. They got to go log in somewhere else. If they got to look at Edivate, which is a professional development tool, they got to go log into that. What this creates is one single log on for our teachers, a one-stop shop, if you will. And what it allows us to do is further our one-to-one initiative. And really, all of that is about personalized learning for students. You know, every child learns differently. Every child learns, you know, that's the beauty of 24/7, 365 learning. But the beauty of technology is that it's allowing us to meet individual student needs like we never have before. Last, and we talked about this, second to last, is really leadership and building capacity. And it's really allowing this team to not only look at the curriculum audit findings and look at the professional development plan, but how do we build our next level of leaders, and what we would call our Learn, Lead, and Grow 2.0 initiative. How do we continue to strengthen the leaders that we have? How do we reach down and pull up the next set of leaders? And how do we continue this capacity of looking at how we learn as adults differently? Face-to-face is good, but it's not the only way. And I think that team is going to have an exciting opportunity to reinvent learning for our organization. Probably said it best, on track and on target, Mr. Watkins and Mr. Brown really said it best. And one of the things that we're positioned well as an organization is the audit recommendation that we have to have a committee together to start looking at assessments. This will be the task of Team 5, and that's to look at our strategic assessment and really looking at how we're monitoring our whole entire assessment system. Are we over-testing? We're over-testing across the country, over-testing across the state, but we have to look at how we're testing by the individual child. What are they looking at? What's that look like in social studies? What's it look like in math? What's it look like in ELA? And how is that impacting the child? We've got a lot of work to do. We've got a lot of work to do in the assessment area as well. But I will tell you this, that it's our focus as a school system to focus on these five themes in this upcoming year and years to come, because I believe that these are key drivers to improvement. One, it helps us connect with the curriculum management audit and how we're going to respond to that, how we're going to do the work, how we're going to bring the work to you. But also we have to look at how we're using our resources to educate all students. It is mission critical. All resources to educate all students moving in the same direction. Whether that is a paraprofessional, whether that's a secretary, whether that's a teacher, whether that's a principal, or whether that's a superintendent, all those resources have to be moving in the same direction. That's why everybody's critical to this mission. Everybody's critical to this mission, this organization. And the work that we do has to be around the frame of equity, equality, culture, and diversity. And all of this, I say, is certainly the Innovation Center. And the Innovation Center, I believe, in my heart of hearts, is going to transform the way that we work in Queen Anne's County Public Schools. It's going to help us work more effectively. It's going to help us work more efficiently. And it's help us going to align our resources in a way that's really going to get to the bottom line. And the bottom line is teaching and learning. The bottom line is closing the achievement gap faster than we ever have before. In the words of Dave Brown, great things happen in Queen Anne's County Public Schools. Mm-hmm. And I will add to his excitement, as you can tell I'm very passionate, is that the outstanding things that continue to happen in Queen Anne's County Public Schools. And I'm honored to have this opportunity to work with all of our leaders to create the Innovation Center.
Thank you.
Thank you. Does anybody have any questions?
Thank you.
Sounds like there's a lot going
She's
on.
Gotta go. Mm-hmm.
Okay, go ahead, Paige. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Beverly, did you have a question?
Just a couple things I see coming from this for our job as the Board of Ed is this could result in basically updates to our mission and vision, because it sounds like be driven from down, you know, with the troops coming up to us, that it may result in changes to that. The other things is we may, which is when I first got on the board, Mr. Simmons was in the commissioners, and he mentioned to me when he met me that the problem with us, he thought, was the fact that we aren't, our budget doesn't reflect our needs, and then we don't have a method of evaluating whether we budgeted for the right things or not. Kind of, that's in a nutshell. And we developed our vision and mission kind of, he felt it, did it in a vacuum. So this plan sounds to me like it'll kind of give us a little bit of organization to go in a direction to help justify our budget some in a better way, maybe.
Be much more much more transparent, I believe, to the public.
Right. Because I think we did, we had a, we thought we, you know, we had a plan, and then, so now we have a big change going on, and you came in, and Dr. Williamson left, and we've been, we want to know what our plan is, and this might be a guide, since we haven't been able to figure out a plan for ourselves and to identify that, that maybe this is a way to help us create that.
Well, and I believe that's true, and I really like your comments, because I think they're dead on, and what I mean by that is that you're exactly right, and it's a question I ask all the time when we look about the effectiveness. So for an example, we look at our reading interventions. How many reading interventions do we have? How much does it cost? And what's working? And what's not working? And how do we redirect resources that we have to maybe purchase a different reading intervention, as an example? So you're exactly right. This whole notion of the Innovation Center will help us drive our needs as an organization and as a school system in a way that can certainly help within the budgeting process. And I really like the fact that you said, Captain Kelly, it comes from the ground up. Certainly the recommendations, when you looked at the one slide, if you noticed which way the arrows were going, they weren't going top down, they were going bottom up. And I think that's this notion of listening. And what I've listened to over the years is our principals have great ideas. Our teachers have great ideas. We've got to empower them to do that work and say that it's okay to do that. Is this the best thinking that we have? And what this is allowing us to do is put the best minds on our challenges to be able to move forward.
So when do you folks meet? I mean, how is it structured?
Sure.
I mean,
great question.
I'm just talking about logistically, how...
Sure.
Everybody's going to be really busy starting
sure.
this month.
Sure. Well, number one, we're about a month behind where I really wanted to be. One of the things that we've asked when we met with our administrators and supervisors is we've asked of the five teams, we've asked them to self-select three of those. Number one is pick your passion. What are you passionate about? So once we get up and running, the team itself from a time, I think that's probably what you're asking, is how much time is this going to take? My estimate would be in doing this work is about 2 hours a month would be the commitment. If you're a senior project manager, it'd be a little bit more than that, probably maybe 3 to 4 hours a month, because you would come and meet with executive staff, give us a briefing on the work of the team, how progress is being made, is your deliverable being on time, and then certainly they would be a part of presenting to the Board of Education. And we would only be running really 10 months a year. We wouldn't really be meeting over the summer to give that kind of transition break. So you're really talking September. You know, our primary goal is to open schools and then be able to start working on the work. Great question.
Thank you.
No, I think it's a great plan. I think that it's going to, in every essence of the word, I mean, you can see the effect that it would have on our children if we can focus on and make this really, you know, be successful and everybody partakes. I mean, focusing on the children's got to be number one. Looking around the room, the pictures that were done, excellent. Focus on the children.
Mm-hmm.
So,
I have to thank Miss Harrison, Mr. Strait, for that,
yeah,
of doing some redecorating.
Yeah, so I'm all for it, and I'll be looking forward to the informative updates to come. Anybody else have any questions or comments?
You know, I just want to add one more thing, and I believe this in my heart of hearts, that I believe the Innovation Center is going to help unite us. It's going to help us unite us as a school district, and it's going to help us move the work forward, and it's going to make us better in the long run.
That should be the plan anyhow.
Yeah, I agree.
I like it because when you were giving your demonstration or your piece, you were saying that everybody to be on the same page and moving forward. And then if someone gets a little slack or whatever, then they can go over and get help from the next person. It's like a collective ongoing thing for everybody to be on the same page and move forward.
Absolutely. And many times when we're doing work and we're bringing an actionable item and it should be delivered at maybe this particular time to be ready to go to be implemented, there's a lot of times where sometimes there's a barrier. Sometimes something else happens. You're not ready to go yet. So it is allowing for that communication of the work as well.
So
and redirect.
I'm not there yet. I mean, you shouldn't it's feel.
Sometimes that's true.
Lighted
we're not there.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Paluski. Next on our agenda is the individual action items. The first thing is the HR report. At this time, I believe we need a motion to approve the HR report.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Do I have any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to approve the HR report. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed?
No.
The ayes have it. Next on the agenda is the transfer within major categories. Are we looking for an approval? We did not go over that. It was in our closed session.
It was in the closed session.
Yeah.
List of things that we were going to talk about.
Right, but we never seemed to have gotten to that point.
No, we did not. Essentially, what this is a list, and I don't seem to have my copy of it right now. This is a request to the county. Luckily, as we are winding down June 30th, we have no categories currently that are over budget. So we are just making a request to transfer funds within each of the categories. And you can see on board docs, there's several categories that we're asking to move money into.
I had some questions on it, but I'm assuming we can't.
Should not have been.
Right, we didn't.
Closed session. Should not have been.
Oh, it shouldn't have been there?
No.
Okay. Oh, okay.
Should have been here. We have to talk about this in open session.
Okay.
Right.
Because the document is in closed session. That's why in our section. I only just had one question. We have money going from salaries to contracted services and then supplies to contracted services. Then lower down, we have salaries to supplies. And then even further down, then you have supplies back to salary. So I'm not understanding why you would first ask for money to transfer from supplies, was it like out of salaries, but then back into salaries? I guess that's my question.
Okay. This is done by major category. So in each category, we have basically six different objects, if you will. You have salaries and wages, contracted services, supplies, other charges, furniture and equipment, and transfers. So within each one of those categories, we have to make it balance. So for example, you see the first major category is administration, and I'm asking to transfer money out of salaries, supplies, and other charges, all into contracted services to cover the cost of our legal fees for the last several months.
Okay.
And then the next category is mid-level administration. So in that category, I'm asking to move money from supplies.
Okay, I see what you're saying.
Other charges.
I understand that.
So
okay.
There's each.
Yeah.
Each category has
right.
Some transfers.
Okay.
That are taking place.
So each category has supply, administration, staff. You know. So
and salaries.
Inside.
Yes.
Inside you're moving it.
Yes.
Not like across the board.
Right. Okay. Yeah.
Jeff?
I'm not moving it from instruction to transportation or something like that. I'm not
okay.
Moving it out of category. It's staying within the category. And within that category, we're moving things up and down to make the budget balance.
Okay.
And basically, since we're not moving it out of category, we don't have to ask for the county commissioner's permission
All we need to do is inform them that we have done this.
Okay. And we need to move stuff out of the general fund and the one category or the other, then we have to ask permission.
Correct? That's correct.
Okay, so at this time, we need a motion to approve the transfer within major categories.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Do I have any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to approve the transfer within major categories. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? The ayes have it.
Ms. George.
Yes. Thank you.
Just a, I like seeing that this has been going on. Can I... I'm going to make a motion that the board appoints Rochelle Eisenberg as legal counsel for the board.
I'm going to second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion?
Just the main thing is the reason being the contract, as you can see in our administration, we've spent about $54,000 on legal fees in addition to $40,000 something last month. So we'd like to bring that down.
Okay. Then I have a motion on the table to, could you repeat that? I'm sorry.
Yes, I think I make the motion that the board appoints Rochelle Eisenberg as legal counsel for the board.
Okay. The motion is to appoint Rochelle Eisenberg as legal counsel for the board. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? The ayes have it. Next on the agenda is the policies. It's a third and final read of the Title IX, Child Abuse and Non-Discrimination. Do anybody?
I would refer to Mr. Farr. Are there any questions that you might have? This is going to be, I believe it's in, this is the third and final read. And I think since Mr. Farley came on, I think he had a chance to take a look at it. He was only here about a couple of days. And if there are any questions, I don't know. I don't think, Mr. Farley, that we received any feedback from the public regarding that.
And the only modification to the non-discrimination Title IX policies was the addition of gender identity.
Okay.
So,
just a question on Title IX policy. Just a note, if you could change page 5 of 11, you still have Mr. Lazard in there as a point of contact.
Okay. So, are we putting that out for the third and final read?
I have to now since we're making the
change.
Yeah, for the third read.
Okay. So, I need a motion to put the policies out for the third and final read of Title IX, Child Abuse and Non-Discrimination.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to put the policies for the third and final read, Title IX, Child Abuse and Non-Discrimination. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? The ayes have it. Next is the textbooks, the second / final read of the Science Genetics book and the English series, My Perspective. Does anybody have anything or any more information? Or
that's a question. That all of them are no cost, I noticed, on all those forms. Are these all a no cost, these novels, or aren't listed for any prices?
There would be a cost. I believe all of them packaged together, I think it was about $6,000 for all of them. I'll have to double check that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, I need a motion to put the textbook second and final read, Science, Genetics, and English Series, My Perspective, out.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to put the textbooks Science, Genetics, and English Series, My Perspective, out for their second and final read. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it.
Oh, she said this is actually the final because textbooks are only put out twice.
Yeah, I said second and final.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, and next we have the reading series, which would also be the second and final read. There are 5 novels entitled Bud, Not Buddy, Gifts, Ender's Game, Hitch, and The Red Scarf Girl. I need a motion to put...
Sorry, that was the one that had no cost. The first one had the cost listed. I'm sorry, I got the wrong.
And that was the $6,000. I apologize.
The novels? Yes.
Correct.
Okay, I apologize.
So moved, Ms. George.
Okay, I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to put the reading series out for the second and final read of the five novels, Bud Not Buddy, Gifts, Ender's Game, Hitch, and Red Scarf Girl. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, the ayes have it. Moving along on the agenda, we have the future action items. Policies, second read for the military, and policy on policies.
Could I refer to Mr. Farley on this, because we had postponed?
I'm sorry?
Yes.
Military policy.
Mr., yeah, we...
And I believe, Mr. Farley, on the second read of these policies as well, we did not receive any public comment.
That's correct.
Were there any feedback?
Right.
I do have one item on the military one that, I don't know where they got the wording on, if it was not dishonorable. There's honorable, and then there's two more. There's honorable, other than honorable situation, and there's a general discharge. And those are different variances of the severity of the problem.
Are these elements of the USARA rights, Captain?
No, I'm just looking at the military instruction. And there's one section there where you say they can't get this benefit if they have anything that is not dishonorable.
Other than honorable, I think.
And there's a terminology of other than honorable. There's an actual discharge you get called other than honorable.
I'll have another look at that. Thank you.
Yeah, just clarify that, because that's a little confusing. There's also a general, and that is not an honorable discharge. So you might want to just do it the other direction and say honorable, and I can talk to you about that. And just say you have to have an honorable discharge to receive these benefits.
Or wouldn't you also grant a general?
No, general, like for the Coast Guard, if someone has a drug offense, they get a general discharge. Mm. So I don't know if you want to be giving this benefit to people that get, otherwise they're zero. Get honorable discharge, that's the best thing you can get. And then after that, there's different punishments, and one of them is general right away for having one drug incident. So it's kind of confusing when you say, because there is also discharge in other than honorable situations or other than honorable, you know, case. So there are different technicalities on definition, and it might be worth just being sure we're right on that, because people will pick that up if they're in the military.
A helpful observation. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Sure. No problem.
I have a question on the policy on policies. Under policy development, adoption, review, number one, it has here, the policy development or revision can be initiated in the following manner: by the superintendent to comply with established policy development activities, and then B, by a majority vote of the board upon recommendation of one or more of the board members. I don't understand why it would come from us. Wouldn't it come from, certainly from the superintendent or even MSDE?
It certainly should, but there may be circumstances under which you would like to have those topics addressed under policy.
Okay, but we make sure they're in alignment with MSDE, I mean, Comar, and okay.
Sure.
I just didn't understand why the majority of the, why that line is even in there. Is that in line with other school systems?
Yes.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure. Thank you very much.
Okay, so I need a motion to put the policies out for a second read of the military and policy on policies.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote on policies to go out for a second read for the military and policy on policies. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed, the ayes have it. Next is the policy. There's three that are going out for a first read. It's the curriculum expense for students, negotiation regulations, and education that is multicultural program. I guess we need a little background on those.
Yep.
Sure. A little background would include, first of all, my not speaking very much about the curricular expense for students. Second, negotiations regulations is really just meant to clarify when negotiations occur, how they occur, under whose authority, with what parameters. It just is meant to make it a little more clear going forward. Finally, the education is multicultural is a procedure, not a policy, being shared with you to illustrate how we will collapse the various task forces and committees currently engaged in multicultural work to get better results in the improved diversity of our applicant pool, the improved awareness in our culture of diversity issues, the improved celebration in our community about our role in diversity.
Okay. So on the curricular expense, it's my understanding historically that we did not have a policy on curricular expenses for students, because I think one of the things that was found was the fact that students were being excluded from a course because they had to pay for instructional materials. And so what this is allows for, that all students have an equal opportunity, should there be an expense to a particular class, that that wouldn't prohibit them from taking the particular course. So I know the folks have, our staff has worked on this, revising this, looking at other jurisdictions when it comes to policy around curricular expense for students.
I would really appreciate seeing the procedures on how it is determined that your students would be charged for extra for the curricular materials due to breakage of student carelessness and irresponsible behavior. I think we're setting ourselves up for problems with parents.
Yep.
On that score, if we don't have procedures in place. Yeah, I'd like to have a rationale, if you don't mind. I mean, it would just be prudent.
And could you give us an example of something that has happened? No, not yours, but that something has happened where they've been omitted from taking a course?
And I think that's what was shared with me historically. Maybe for an example, it may have been a lab fee that a student may not have been able to pay.
And they didn't go to, they couldn't go to class and take the class?
That's my understanding. And I think that was one of the things as to why the policy became, why we had to have the policy, was to ensure that that wasn't happening.
Okay, at this time I need a motion to put the three policies out for the first read: the curriculum expense for students, negotiations, regulations, and education that is multicultural program.
I
have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to put the policies out for the first read of the curricular expense for students, negotiation, regulations, and education as multicultural program. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? The ayes have it. Moving along, the procedures, public information request. Does anybody have any questions regarding that?
I do.
Okay.
Personnel records. There's a section in there on student personnel. I believe it is four. It says that an elected official is able to get a personnel record, and I really don't understand why that.
These rules on Public Information Act requests come directly from the COMAR, and are meant to meet our legal obligations. So it's simply restating what the law is as to exceptions and rights of people to get access to records.
Well, it also states on here a person of interest. The person in interest, I mean, that's the person.
That's the person's
and
record.
And then an elected or appointed official who supervises the work of the individual. I mean, aren't we supposed to protect our personnel, their records?
I think we're, excuse me, I'm having some difficulties here. The rule is meant to provide the broadest access with very specific exemptions and exclusions. So that's pretty much what we have to live with, to be honest, Ms. Harper. Right? We do have an obligation to protect our documents and our private records. And that's why we set up this process for Mr. Strait to follow as our public information officer.
Thank you.
You don't have to give them permission. You can have the person of interest doesn't need to give permission for all these entities. Like the PTA can get a hold of someone's address. I mean, I think I can't believe that's in the law.
I'll be happy to share it with you.
It says parent organizations and other organizations in the school can get it, the student's address and phone number.
And that's because it's considered general or directory information. There are different rules for that level of information. So let me provide you with the reference so you can look at it.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, are we putting, this is a procedure, not a policy.
That's correct.
Are we just voting, we don't really vote on procedures. Is this just to inform us of the procedure?
Correct.
Okay.
So we don't send it out for reads or anything?
No. It's just, just giving us the procedure that we are going to be right. following.
School system, how they implement it.
And we just have questions, you know. That's great. Just want to protect the information of of our staff and our students, that's
sure.
all. Yeah. I mean, the highest level.
Of course.
Okay, next item on the agenda are the reports, and the first one is the superintendent's report.
Just a couple quick highlights. Number one, I had a great opportunity a few weeks ago to attend with Ms. Susan Davis, as well as with Ms. DiMaggio, to the where our migrant workers have just migrated from Brownsville, Texas, and where they have gone without 2 weeks before they receive their pay. And it was a generous donation of free food. It was a food giveaway. And I will tell you, I just to look on their faces and meet the children about how appreciative they were to get them through these next couple weeks. Also with Ms. DiMaggio, Commissioner Steve Wilson was there as well. And I actually watched Mr. Wilson donate $1,000 of his own money to have a second night for parents and food giveaway. And it was amazing just to be able to help and support those families. So I thank all those that were involved. A lot of our staff from the migrant program were there supporting the families and supporting the needs. I thought was wonderful. The other thing is that I recently met with Sheriff Hoffman. And I also met with Chief Rhodes, and I've been in dialogue with them, just not only one getting to know them. I know we have a great partnership with our law enforcement. Mr. Pender and I also met at that time with Chief Rhodes. But the whole dialogue there is to continue the partnership with law enforcement. Where we're meeting with great success? Where are their areas? How can we strengthen? As we all know that safety and security is our number one priority, health and well-being, and certainly academic performance. So I've been reviewing all of our emergency procedures with Mr. Pender as we get ready to open up the school year. So those are a quick couple highlights. The last is, and I'll share this because this was so exciting, I had a chance to Ms. Kim Seidel, our new principal at Sellersville Elementary School, I had an opportunity to go to her open house, and it was very exciting. Her families and her children are very glad that she's there. So I'm appreciative having the opportunity to head up there that night. So I thank her for her leadership.
The migrant school dinner was very good, too. It was very well attended and very, very nice, and the kids were so excited. And a lot of great work done over the week. Over the weeks with
it's tremendous.
Yeah, it's very nice. Yeah,
I have a question on your July 20th, the migrant food giveaway. You have down the Queen Anne's County Public Schools held their first one. We held that giveaway, the Queen Anne's County Public Schools.
No.
Because I didn't hear anything about it, and I would have liked to attend.
Sure.
I didn't know anything about it, and neither, you know, so with this, maybe we should advertise this next time. So. More sure. of us
wasn't,
can go.
But it wasn't, that wasn't done through, yeah, that I was some type of so Northern that, Queen Anne's County backpack program.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
So I apologize, Captain Kelly. Yeah, that was a misprint
maybe,
on mine.
It
wasn't
give
necessarily
to Jeff
sanctioned.
And he can put it on the website because I think a lot of people like to have been a part of that to donate
you.
Stuff.
It should be on the website, I would think. Because I look at all those weekly you know, things that he puts out and I didn't see anything about it. I would have come to it.
Yeah, and
good event.
Certainly, and so I do apologize. That was but I also think it brought to light to me how much more we can do.
Yeah,
and you know how we need to be thinking at the end of the school year and taking donations and how can we do more? Because we certainly can. I believe Ms. DiMaggio, correct me if I'm wrong, but it was basically $1,000 that the county commissioners had donated
the. First $1,000 because the children that are in this migrant camp at Friels attend Sellersville Middle School's migrant summer school program. That's why I went and I asked for the money, and that's how we got the first $1,000. And then Mr. Wilson attended with us along with yourself, and after he saw all the good deeds that were being done, he decided to donate $1,000 of his own money. We did it again the following week, so.
That's great.
Thanks. 2 weeks in a row.
It was very nice.
Yeah, we'd well like done. To attend that because it's got sure. our migrant program in it. And
well, just I'm gonna blow smoke for Julie Alley. She, I am, because she got several, most of the older students during the migrant school certified in CPR. And I, how wonderful is that to be able to take back home with them and hopefully they don't have to use it, but maybe they'll teach others. So it was kudos to her and to the staff and definitely the students for partaking in that.
Thank you.
The other thing I noticed on your CNI report, you're kind of both those reports, superintendent.
We'll put that out on
all of the presentations. I'm sorry, she left Ms. Schindler. She did a bunch of presentations with the SWIFT UDL fellows. Can you describe what that is? Apparently, it's a national organization that she presented, representing Queen Anne's County. That
sure is that's for the SWIFT, I believe.
Right.
Yep. So the SWIFT is really a framework it's grounded in implementation science. And what that basically means is, as I was talking about earlier, how do you get a better implementation of whatever it is that you're implementing in order to sustain long-term results? And a lot of that really, it's not a special ed initiative, although it's been funded by the federal, by the state, and we're one of, I believe, four in the state implementing that framework at four schools. But she has taken the lead. She's really our district kind of representative. And the SWIFT framework has recognized the work that we've done in Queen Anne's County as exceptional. And she was there to present on behalf of the school system that the organization has seen that we're the furthest school district out of all the schools that have been piloting this. I think that's a tribute to not only her work, but the work of our schools on deepening the implementation of that. The UDL Fellowship, which is Universal Design for Learning, which is part of the law in Maryland, and that is really about equal access to instructional resources for all students. So when we talk about instructional delivery, that allows teachers strategies to be able to engage kids, allow kids how they represent their learning. And she's part of a fellowship at Towson University with a very selected, I think it's about four or five individuals with Dr. Grasmick, of really about deepening this work and how that work and the professional development that districts are doing around UDL. So she's been a great ambassador of representing us as a school district.
Great. My last question, overall, in the summer, all of the stuff throughout your report indicates there's a lot of teacher input back in July as far as evaluating what we did and what the future is going to bring and the curriculum. And are the teachers compensated for this? Because I know they're basically their school year is over.
Sure. As far as curriculum writing or as far as absolutely, they get paid $20 an hour. And you know, I will always advocate for that we should probably try to increase that as time goes on. I know in other jurisdictions it's about $30 an hour, $35 depending. But yes, they are compensated for that. They're compensated on an hourly rate.
Because it's throughout the month.
It is. It is. And that's something we've got. All of our curriculum folks are doing multiple things throughout the summer, towards the end, curriculum writing, assessment revision, planning professional development. And having sat this summer, and I've talked to teachers doing that work and certainly thank them, because that's the work they're doing is helping other teachers. And all of our curriculum instruction staff. I mean, teachers feel empowered. I think that's a very important thing, because the work that goes out to other teachers has been by teachers for teachers, and I think that's important.
Yeah, it is. That's great. Thank you.
Anything else you want to mention from the CNI report? I know Captain Kelly had pick through some stuff. I just didn't know if you had anything else.
No, we're just all about opening schools and trying to get all of our resources and the alignment and all that set up and the professional development ready to roll.
Okay. This is the expenditure report.
Robin?
Well, we're only a month into the new year, so there's really not too much to report on at this point in time. You know, generally I point out any variances greater than $10,000 or 10%, and we're not in that situation in any category at this point in time. So,
and your audit starts when?
The audit started this week, started on Monday. And that'll be reported back to you on the October board meeting.
Okay. Any other questions? No. Okay. Now it's our second citizen participation public comment section.
Yes, Ms. Vera Wolski.
Wolski.
Okay.
Good evening. I just wanted to introduce myself. I know some of you, but I haven't met all of you. My name is Vera Wolski. I'm a paraprofessional up at Stevensville Middle School, but I'm also the vice president in charge of ESP for the Queen Anne's County Education Association. So I just wanted to introduce myself. I sent many of you back in the spring an email. I just wanted you to know that I'm available at any time if there's anything to work with this board, because I feel like the association and the board really need to work together for the kids' sake. And I had met Mr. Pelosi and I had met Mr. Farley, so I just kind of wanted to introduce myself. And you brought up something at the very beginning about extending teacher contracts. I just wanted to make sure that when we go into extending the teacher contracts, that we also say ESP contracts, because they're completely separate. So if you extend the teacher contracts and don't extend ESP, we're not getting paid.
Okay, very good.
So I just wanted to bring that up, because you're going to, I would think, have to vote to extend both contracts, because they are separate contracts.
Okay. Thank
you for bringing that up, Ms. Wolski. And on that vein,
I just wanted to introduce myself and say hello. That's all.
Thank you very much.
Nice to see you, Vera. I'm going to make the motion to extend the ESP and teacher contracts for a 30-day period.
A second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to extend the ESP and teachers' contracts for 30 days. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you, Ms. Wolski. Next is our upcoming meetings and events. We have a MABE conference.
We do. That's the annual MABE conference that is going to be October 5, 6, and 7th, and I believe that's in Ocean City. Mm-hmm. Is the annual conference. So just a point of clarification, has all the board gone to that in the past, or representatives, or?
Make a point. We have a board meeting on the 5th.
On the 5th, yeah.
So do we move the board meeting to the 12th?
Have the board meeting.
I guess
that not be prudent?
Right. No, I think that would be exactly what we'd have to do.
Okay. So we need a motion. Make a motion to move the October 5th Board of Education meeting to October 12th.
Okay.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to move the October 5th board meeting to October 12th. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it.
I think if people are planning to go, there is a reduced rate on registration if you get in before August 8th, is it, Jackie?
I think August 8th is.
I think it's August 8th, so we have to go ahead and we could save money.
Mm-hmm.
I guess if you could let Jackie know if you have an interest in attending, then get a list together of who's going to attend on behalf of the public schools. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes. Okay, next on there, we have the board retreat.
Yes, I was. I had put this on there as a discussion item that certainly, as a part of the Innovation Center and certainly the audit, getting your feedback on having a retreat for one day and really getting a chance to really dig into some goals, dig into some challenges of our school system, have a dialogue about that, which would, I think, certainly be beneficial for me as well, of the work that you'd like for me to focus on, and then be able to use that as part of our overall strategic plan and framework.
That's good.
No, it's fine with me. Does that date work with everybody? It
that
doesn't.
Would be the
that's a back-to-school night for Mattapique Middle.
Well,
August 26th, is it?
It is. That would be a
daytime.
Friday. It would be during the day.
Oh, daytime, okay.
Yeah.
Like a 9 to 3? Ms. Harper?
I can't.
Okay. Is there a date that you could, that we could all do that?
October.
Is this year to work with your, on your innovation discussion?
Well, I think part of it, I also think part of it is looking at some of the recommendations that were made in the audit and standard one, having that kind of conversation, but also talking about some of the major challenges as a team of board members that you see are facing as a priority of our school system that you'd like me to focus on and work towards, and that collaborative effort of having that and focusing really on that strategic plan piece as well.
Can I email you all tomorrow? I have to
confer
with my managers and get stuff straight. That's a big day.
I'm okay.
Is that all right? Can I do that?
Fine. Yeah.
Okay. So keep it.
Okay.
Awesome. Thank you.
Okay. At this time, I need a motion to close open session.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second? I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to close open session. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you for attending, and see you next month.